different databases hold information about different aspects of proteins. There are databases for sequence, structure, dynamics, catalytic activity, biological function, scientific literature, domain classification, and many others. UniProt is a unified protein database that aggregates information from different databases into a unified form. Each UniProt entry is annotated based on the source databases and links back to them. Understanding how to use UniProt is a vital part of modern protein research. In this video, we will learn how to search for proteins, how to filter down the results, and how to read the protein entry. This is the UniProt homepage. As you can see, there are several tools and ways to browse the data in it. We can use the search input to look for proteins based on keywords. Since I'm not feeling very creative today, we'll use one of the examples. Insulin and search. As expected, we got a lot of results. For each result, we can see the UniProt identifier and name, the protein name, gene, organism, and amino acid sequence length. We could customize the columns if we're interested in other fields. Since we searched for a very common protein, we got a lot of results, and we would probably want to filter them down. On the left side, we can see a filter menu, which allows us to reduce the number of results. Let's go over a few ways to do that. We can filter results by the reviewed status. Proteins that have been manually reviewed and curated are stored in the SwissProt database. Proteins that have not yet been reviewed are stored in the Tremble database. Reviewed SwissProt entries are usually of higher quality and backed by better methods and experiments. We can also filter by a specific organism or taxonomy. We may also be interested only in proteins with an experimentally determined structure, a known function, or structural motif. If we're interested only in proteins with an observed structure, we would filter by protein's existence protein level. This would usually get us the most reliable protein structures. The higher the annotation score, the more reliable the overall annotations of the entries are. Let's filter only reviewed entries belonging to humans that contain an experimentally determined structure with the highest annotation score. This significantly reduced the number of results. Let's look at the first entry. At the top of the page, we can see the UniProt identifier and name, followed by general details. On the left, we can see a menu that allows us to navigate to any section of the page. Note the little eye symbol next to each field name. Clicking it shows documentation relevant to that field. Here we see a description of the protein function. Aside of the description itself, we also get a reference to the source of this information. We can see that this information has been inferred by sequence similarity. We can also see the source publications for this information. The publication list contains links to the PubMed entries, which we can read further if we're interested. If the protein has a catalytic activity, we can see the exact reaction it catalyzes. This section too has references to the sources of this information. EC, or enzyme classification number, uniquely identifies this catalytic activity. Information about reactions is curated in the REA database. Here we see sequence features such as binding sites or active sites. For example, we can see that in position 66 there is an insulin binding site, and in position 1033 there is an ATP binding site. GO annotations, or gene ontology annotations, are a standard way to classify molecular function, biological process, and cellular component. We can see, for example, the different cellular components this protein is known to be found in. We can also see the non-molecular functions of the protein and the biological processes it is involved in. Here we have links to external databases for different chemical and biological aspects of the protein. This section shows us the known subcellular locations of the protein. This is a transmembrane protein, and we can see that these regions are extracellular, this is a transmembrane helix, and this is a cytoplasmic region. This section shows us known variants of the proteins and the known related disease it is associated with. This section shows us post-translation modifications of specific residues or processing of entire regions. For example, we can see cases of disulfide bond formation between a pair of residues, residue glycosylation, or residue phosphorylation. This section contains information about the expression of the protein. For example, what tissues express it. This section contains known information about the interaction of this protein with other proteins. Here we can see all known structures of the protein. If it has experimentally determined structures, we will see their PDB identifiers and links to PDB pages. In addition to the experimentally determined structure, there is also AlphaFold predicted structure. For the majority of the entries which do not have experimentally determined structure, the AlphaFold predicted structure will be the only one. For the selected structure, we can see the secondary structure in each region. Here we see known domain classifications for regions in the protein. Regions that are not annotated with any specific domain may still be classified, for example, as insulin binding or disordered regions. Some proteins have multiple isoforms, which are different sequences that are still considered the same protein, and here we can see them. The final section shows similar proteins. For example, we can see proteins that have 90% identity or 50% identity. We may be interested in similar proteins in order to construct multiple sequence alignment or study structural differences between them. We have gone through the entire entry page, but there is another way to view the same content. In the top menu, we can choose Feature Viewer, and this shows us the same content we saw before, but in the context of the sequence. For example, we can see a glycosylation site in this domain. Now that we are familiar with the entry fields, we can use them to search for proteins. In the advanced search, we can use specific fields, such as gene name or taxonomy, to search for the proteins of interest. This is by no means a comprehensive review of UniProt. There are many fields that we did not cover. As you work with UniProt, you will get familiar with all the aspects of it. One thing I think is worth clarifying is the difference between UniProt and the protein data bank. In UniProt, each entry is a polypeptide chain, while in the PDB, each entry is a structural assembly, which may contain any number of polypeptide chains, or no polypeptide chains at all. For example, some of the entries in the PDB are actually nucleic acids. In UniProt, there are no complexes, only single polypeptide chains. Both databases reference each other. A PDB entry may contain different polypeptide chains, each referencing a UniProt entry, and a UniProt entry may reference different PDB structures containing that polypeptide chain. Remember that the PDB is one of the source databases for a UniProt entry. I hope this introduction was helpful. In future videos, we will learn how to make use of the information from UniProt. I'll see you then.